Hey, Pillars, and welcome back to Another Race Highlight. We're taking a look at the 2024 UCI Gravel World Championships happening in Belgium. So a super interesting gravel race. Now, if you can call it gravel, but I will have a timestamp on screen. So if you want to fast forward to see the highlights, it will be on screen right now. But I do want to touch up on the course profile to show you guys what's in store. So let's jump into that right now. So the elite men are doing 182 kilometers across the province of Flemish Brabant and two finishing in the circuit in Leuven. Now there's a mix, I already touched up on it on my preview. It's a mix of road surfaces, canal lanes, forests. It's like cyclocross mixed into it. And it's a pretty dynamic in terms of a gravel race, meaning that watching this, you will see a bunch of terrain being covered. So it is going to be super dynamic and super interesting. And my pick for this Gravel Worlds, I already put it in my preview. It's Mathieu the Cyborg Vanderpool. I think that's the one that's going to take, but we're going to have to see. Belgium has the strongest squad on paper. So if they can really control the race. Now you might be asking about Mate Morovic from Slovenia, previous 2023 Gravel World Champion. What can he do? His squad isn't that strong. So maybe if he's somewhere solo, he's going to have to go on the attack. Maybe watch Mathieu Vanderpool. It's going to be a very dynamic race tactically, but on paper, we have Mathieu Vanderpool that is most likely going to take it. So with that being said, let's jump into the race highlights right now. So jumping into the highlights with 78.8 kilometers left to go, there was a lead group of 2 minutes and 28 seconds on the chasing group. And that was a pretty big group of 16 riders. We had the likes of Stuyven, Melier, Vermeersch. There was also Mathieu Vanderpool, Swift from GB. We also had Mate Morovic, which is the 2023 Gravel World Champion. So this 16 rider that had about 2 minutes on the peloton, the chasing peloton, was huge. At this point, the decisive move of who's going to win the Gravel World Championships was already from this breakaway, because with 22 minutes and 45 seconds, with 76 kilometers left to go, with hitters like Mathieu Vanderpool and Mateo Morovic, and then all of Belgium, this was a decisive move. So if you weren't in this breakaway group, you're not going to win the Gravel Worlds. You're not even going to get a top 10 finish. So basically, I just want to show on screen, in terms of the course profile, it was very dynamic in terms of the racing they were going through. I wouldn't even call this gravel. When I think of gravel, I'm thinking of flint roads. I'm thinking of rocks. This is kind of just like bike paths. So it's pretty much like bike world champion. And I would say, in terms of my opinion on this gravel race, it was dynamic. It was interesting to see what Belgium, and I think that's what's interesting about gravel, is you get to see what type of quote unquote gravel there is in different parts of the world. But in my opinion, coming from North America, I wouldn't say this is truly a gravel world, in my opinion. But basically, this front group of the 16 riders, we know at some point there's going to have to be a control. And that's where, with 65 kilometers left to go, Belgium goes on the front and they have the manpower to really control this race. You just see the dust flying. I would say this is some good gravel, but it goes back to tarmac, and you can see the lead group of these 16 riders, Belgium is in control. So Mathieu Vanderpool is going to have to watch, and then Mathieu Morovic is all by himself. So with 60 kilometers left to go, Mathieu Vanderpool says, I'm going to go on the attack. You can see Morovic in the green trying to go behind, and from GB we have Connor Swift. He's trying everything that he can do to latch on to Mathieu Vanderpool's wheel, and they didn't actually have a lot of synergy on this attack. Mathieu Vanderpool had to do basically everything, and Belgium's job right now is to close it down. Now, one thing, unfortunately, that Mathieu Morovic kept doing was trying to basically work for Belgium. And it's like, Belgium has all these riders. Why are you doing anything? So Mathieu Vanderpool on this attack is trying to do everything that he can to work with Swift. But Connor Swift is not working with him. So basically, it was just a solo Mathieu Vanderpool attack. And Swifty is not going to do anything to help Mathieu Vanderpool. So it kind of was a failed attack, because with Belgium chasing and Mathieu Morovic being also very motivated to work with Belgium. So you can see Mathieu Morovic is trying to close that gap. We just see MVDP and Swift just trying to rotate. But at that point, Belgium is going to chase it down. At one point, Mathieu Morovic looked like he was really losing the wheel, but he was just conserving his energy, trying to get Belgium to do the work, because why would you do the work when there's like four Belgium riders? So he does it smart. He says, I'm not going to be working for you guys anymore. Catches back on, and he's going to recover with 56 kilometers. There's discussions going along when it all comes together. So that selection went down from Mathieu Vanderpool's attack. It went from 16 riders. And I think at this point, there was around seven riders, if I'm not mistaken. So six Belgians still in that mix. Mathieu Vanderpool actually removed six Belgians, and he has still four with him. So he really disintegrated the group in terms of that breakaway. It was just all Belgium represented. So with 42 kilometers left to go, they have a pretty sizable gap on the rest of that original breakaway. And you'll just see attacks from Belgium. Now, with 46 kilometers, Belgium is going to try everything that they can do to just send riders up the road. and to get Mathieu van der Poel to chase. Because why does Belgium need to chase? They just need to stick on Mathieu van der Poel's wheel just in case he catches, which he does, and it comes all together. And we see, I think that Swift on the front, we have Mathieu Maurits in third wheel. So now it's just a cat and game mouse between Belgium and then Netherlands and Slovenia in terms of who's going to attack. This section was pretty cool. It was like a parking lot that they went up. So like I said at the beginning, it's very dynamic in terms of the course profile for a gravel race. It's a mix of everything, which I would say gravel is pretty much the spirit of gravel is dead at this point when you have aero everything. So with 45 kilometers left to go in the race, Belgium's on the front, everything's all together. And it's Belgium's race to lose, in my opinion. With a group like this, you have four Belgium riders. Mathieu van der Poel is the strongest one here. You just have to mark Mathieu van der Poel and slowly burn riders just in case he attacks to close. So all the other, the chase group, which we have on screen right now with 46 kilometers, you know, why would they chase? Because a lot of those riders are Belgium. So why would they be chasing their four teammates up the road? Doesn't make sense. So it's just Belgium, if they don't mark Mathieu van der Poel properly, they're going to lose this race. So we have to see with 46 kilometers, can they control MVDP from attacking? Can they close the gaps? They're making him ride on the front, which is obviously, I think Mathieu van der Poel rather set the pace just in case he does want to attack. He has the instinct that he can make the decisive move. So Belgium is just playing it very smart. We see Mathieu van der Poel right there. And then Swift, I think that's Connor Swift. He goes on the attack, that's a Belgian rider, my mistake. And Mathieu van der Poel has to close those attacks. So that rider is Vermeersch, which I'm pretty sure he's won Gravel Worlds, if I'm not mistaken. So he closes down, and I'm pretty sure their teammates also. So he closes that attack, and this is going to be the decisive attack. So in terms of Belgium, they did the right thing, but it's one of those things where now Vermeersch is going to play 50-50 with Mathieu van der Poel. The rest is not going to chase. So Mathieu Maurits is the one that's going to have to chase from that group, because why would Belgium chase down Vermeersch? And now Mathieu van der Poel is hopefully going to have to work with Vermeersch. And if they made a calculated decision, I think at that point, going for first and second, having that opportunity versus potentially losing it and Mathieu Maurits or Swift get second and third and Mathieu wins, it's better to at least get on the podium for second than losing it. So could Belgium play their cards better at that point if they weren't able to drop? I think they should just have attacked more, but they didn't. So I think they just wanted to play a little bit more conservative for today and just get that guaranteed second place. So with 36 kilometers left to go, they had about 20 seconds. And we know this is most likely going to go to the line because Mathieu Maurits is looking around saying, is anyone going to help me chase? The three riders from Belgium are not going to chase their teammate. Swift is not going to do any work. If he did no work when Mathieu van der Poel was attacking, he just wants to try to get on the podium for free. So now it's just between Mathieu van der Poel and Vermeersch for the first place for the rainbow bands. And we're going to see with 36 kilometers left to go, it's just going to be a cat and game mouse between them. And Mathieu van der Poel on paper, I'm going with him 100% of the time, even though Vermeersch has won. I'm pretty sure if I don't get it right that he's won gravels, then you guys can roast me in the comments. So they're going to go make sure that, I think it was around a 30-second lead, if I'm not mistaken, in terms of the chase group. But like I said, the chase group's not going to chase their own teammate. So they're just making sure that lead is consistent. And Mathieu Maurits is already gassed. Swifty's not going to do anything, like I said. So you're just seeing them work very well together. But Mathieu van der Poel is going to have to decide eventually when he's going to want to attack and drop Vermeersch. It's just a matter of time and obviously picking the right terrain. This Belgium course had a lot of flat sections in terms of gravel sections. So Mathieu van der Poel is going to do that cyborg attack. We have Slovenia on the front, which is Maurits, which he's trying to bridge up. And Belgium obviously has to close that. So they're letting, eventually they do close that because they don't want to potentially for Vermeersch to not get second place. So they have to close that. You see Swifty finally doing work and you'll see Belgium just playing cat and games. So they're hoping Vermeersch can go 50-50 with Mathieu van der Poel. And Maurits just didn't have the legs with him and didn't have the support around him. And Mathieu van der Poel being Mathieu van der Poel, he's going to do Mathieu van der Poel things, which is attack. And I just don't think Maurits had the legs compared to Mathieu van der Poel. So they're just going to keep riding a steady pace, trying to catch Mathieu van der Poel. Maurits is going to have to be the one doing that. And the time gap for this whole section in terms of when they were chasing wasn't anything super crazy in terms of the break. It was only a minute and 22 seconds with about 19 kilometers left to go. So the attack is going to have to come pretty soon from Mathieu van der Poel if he's going to want to try to break away from Vermeersch. But with a minute lead at that point, Mathieu van der Poel has no problem sticking this to the end. And you can see they're going through forests. When I've ridden gravel, these are the most sketchy situations because a mud section can just take your wheel and you can slide out and there goes your race potentially. He's letting Vermeersch go on the front. Mathieu van der Poel's getting ready for that attack that he's planning. So they're taking it nice and easy over these farm roads. Obviously, you want to go in the easiest sections to roll over. You don't want any crazy dirt or grass. So they're going over the most compact sections of the gravel, and we're seeing them working very well together. So there's a vested interest with 15 kilometers left to go. Let's just keep this pace going. We don't want Mohorovic to win. We don't want Swift to win. We don't want Belgium to chase us down. So let's just work together, and we're going to see who has it, who can win 1v1. And it was a very interesting just tactical of when Mathieu van der Poel was going to launch. So it was just waiting. And with exactly 14 kilometers left to go up a climb, Mathieu van der Poel is going to say, you know what? This is like a true classic Belgium race. I'm going to have to attack you, unfortunately. And you're going to see it. He's going to play second wheel. Vermeersch might not even see it coming, which is difficult because once Mathieu van der Poel launches, he has a very explosive. I mean, there he goes. He launches with 13.5 kilometers left to go in the race. And Vermeersch is going backwards, basically. And Mathieu van der Poel, being a heavier set rider but a classics rider, he's able to sustain that effort. And if he gets at least 30 seconds, 40 seconds on you, he's kind of like Tadej Pogačar in terms of just keeping that sustained effort. He's won right now. Vermeersch is not going to catch that unless, you know, Mathieu van der Poel gets popped. But from previous races, when he goes on these solo attacks like Pogačar, they're going to sustain that to the end. So right there, the race has lost. And now Belgium just has to guarantee that they don't let Mohorovic catch up, and they don't want to help him bridge up and potentially wreck second place for them. So Mathieu van der Poel is going to have to do 12.4 kilometers solo TT finish to get his first ever gravel world championships. And Belgium is going to have to do damage control, just making sure that they cover Swifty and that they cover Mohorovic. And like I said, I just want to share my thoughts in terms of the gravel race. It wasn't anything crazy. I personally would have liked it. I just want to share my own opinion. I would have liked it to be at least like 200, 250 kilometers. Now, in terms of the entertainment factor of that, is it entertaining to watch a race that long for viewerships and yada, I don't know. But in terms of a gravel race, the spirit of gravel, it's long dead, but it just felt like this kind of felt like a Strade Bianchi, like a ripoff, like a Walmart version. So I enjoyed watching, obviously, any race that has Mathieu van der Poel racing, I'll always watch it. And it was obviously dynamic. It's just, it wasn't, the gravel didn't really impress me. And I think for gravel, like right now what they're doing, it just looks kind of like a Flanders classic. It just looks like a Belgium classic. But what can you expect? I think for gravel, depending on where it takes place, can really dictate the winner, because when more technical skills need to be incorporated, this is not super technical in terms of, you know, riders. And that's why you're seeing a lot of World Tour riders riding the World Championships for gravel. So Vermeersch, he's just going to try to sustain. He has a 50-second lead on the third chase group that has Mohorovic and Swift. So Belgium's not doing any work. I think maybe he's satisfied that he's going to get second place. And like I said, you guys can roast me. I'm pretty sure, I'm like 99% sure he won in 2022. Yeah, he won in 2022. MVDP, 1.3 kilometers, 55 second lead. He's chilling. He's going to take it. This part's not even technical. It's just like backwards. And he's going to take it to the line. And we're going to see him basically save his 2024 season. And I say that after he won Paris-Roubaix, but in terms of not being able to repeat the Worlds, but then again, very hilly course, got third. For him to get Gravel Worlds, I would say it's a dub. I would say for him to get that on the Palmares, very good to see. Mathieu van der Poel takes his Gravel World Championships, gets off the canyon, takes it up, praises it. He's the GOAT of gravel, I would say, in terms of off-road. I would like to see Pidcock actually in this race. I'm surprised Pidcock didn't do it. It would be pretty interesting to see Pidcock head-to-head. We have Vermeersch that was able to sustain his second place. I think he'll be satisfied with that. And I'm probably going to get roasted in the comments because I'm pretty sure he did not. No, I don't know at this point. And then we're going to see third place get battled out between Belgium, Slovenia, and GB. So we're going to see Belgium's trying to do some fake attacks, and it is a Belgium rider that gets third place. So Belgium, for being able to go second and third, but not on the podium, I would say they played their cards right. Like, this is the analysis part of how the race unfolded. I think Belgium did everything they needed to do in terms of, I don't think they messed up tactically. It was with a rider like Mathieu van der Poel, with not having so many decisive positions to really attack, unless they were going, I think they could have just been a little bit more aggressive attacking, but they did play it very conservatively. And I think the conservative aspect of how they raced was the reason why they didn't get first place, because they could have just really tried to tire out Mathieu van der Poel. But I feel like Mathieu van der Poel just really scared them, and he controlled the entire race just with that aura. So that's how Gravel World Championships was won. I found it pretty mediocre to watch. I wasn't that impressed with it, but I like the fact that gravel obviously is getting taken a lot more serious. So I'll leave it there. If you guys did enjoy this video, smash a like, subscribe to the channel. Obviously trying to get these highlights out to you guys as fast as possible. So if you do appreciate that, then let me know. And until the next one, keep on pedaling.